This is KT Connects, hosted by the Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research and Arthritis Research Canada. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Kendall Ho. Dr. Kendall Ho is an emergency medical specialist at Vancouver General Hospital in Vancouver, BC, Canada. A professor at the UBC Faculty of Medicine Department of Emergency Medicine and a member of the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Canada. He leads the Digital Emergency Medicine Unit, and his areas of research include sensors and wearables in healthcare settings, health apps to improve patient care, virtual health to support care access, and raising digital health literacy for health professionals and patients. Today, he is here to present on technology-enabled knowledge translation for digital health, a topic that Kendall has been working on for some 15 years. So thank you, Kendall, for being here, and I'm going to pass the presentation over to you now.
Great. Thank you very much, Martin. And really appreciate, first, thanks to Michael Smith Foundation Health Research for inviting me to this really exciting series of KT Connects. So very exciting. Also, thanks to all those who are currently online. Despite the fact that I don't see you, I hope that our voices will connect, and I look forward to your questions and some dialogues together. And so, as Martin said, I'm very interested in looking at technology, and so today's exploration of how technology can support knowledge translation. And love to share some of the insights and lessons learned so far that I've got, and also love to learn from you during this exchange. I want to do an unusual disclosure. I love Food Channel, and one of my favorite program was Recipes to Riches. And the reason I want to bring that up is because this was, I can't think of a better example of what KT is about. I remember season 2012, and I was watching the program, and there's this gentleman from Toronto who's pitching butter chicken lasagna. And once I heard that name, I said, I want to try this. And so I was glued to the screen this season and watching him going from the single portion recipe pitching to the president of Loblaws as one of the judges. And then over time, he then produced 300 portions and then packaged it into a branding. And eventually he was the winner of that season. And I know that in 3 months' time after that season, I should be able to get it from a superstore market. And sure enough, 3 months later, there was an announcement. And that night, I rushed down to the superstore, got one of those, ate it, felt completely satisfied. Here's an example of a person in Toronto with a recipe that eventually get distributed so any Canadian can have access to it. When you think about it, what we are doing in terms of type of research, in type of health that we do, it's about a clinical pathway. It's about a medication. It's about an action. And with that, we want to have the opportunity not only to benefit our local sites, it is proven effective, but also to be able to spread across Canada. And so I like the CHRA older definition to break knowledge translation into four parts. First, it's about knowledge synthesis. What has been done? What are we adding to the knowledge? And in the results, what's the new knowledge that we have? But secondly, how do we disseminate it? How do we then spread that knowledge forward? But more importantly, it's about knowledge exchange. It's not understanding what that knowledge does, but how does it do in the context where we are across Canada, across globally? And then finally, how do we apply that knowledge into practice, ethically sound application? So it's not just about the fact that I know about it, but as a clinician, I want to use it. As a patient, I want to adopt it. As a health policy person, I want to integrate into legislature or policies. And so 2006, I think Dr. Ian Graham from CHRA brought up this really excellent knowledge to action circle. And in many ways, knowledge translation is still very much in many parts of using this circle. The center circle is about the knowledge synthesis piece. But once the knowledge is there, the circle around the center circle is the action circle. How do you look from the left side of your screen, knowledge to local contacts? How do you adopt it? What's in the barriers? How do you implement it? And then to the right side is look, how do we evaluate the outcome and the PDSA cycle so that we can continue to sustain and use that knowledge forward. And so today, what I'd like to explore with you is what roles can technology play in this knowledge to action? What are some of the things that technology can do to help us accelerate knowledge translation? And I'm going to talk with you a little bit about my bias in terms of being digital emergency medicine. and how do we look at areas of knowledge translation and some of the research that we've done to date, and also want to hear your thoughts about what you do and where we can learn. So how can technology support health professional patient relationship, communication, better outcome, improve evidence-based decision, and also knowledge exchange with the stakeholders? In doing so, I'm going to look at four trends that perhaps would be interesting to consider for our discussion. And I'll bring up those four trends over time. But first, maybe I'll explain a little bit what digital emergency medicine is about. Emergency medicine, as an emergency doctor, I sit in the space between acute care and hospital in community. And so for patients, they come to emergency, they come to hospital often through emergency departments because they feel that there's an urgent issue. And so we stabilize the patient, either admit them to hospital, facilitate that, or send them home with safety and treatment. But of course, the idea is that we want to keep the patients at home well so that we prevent any future unexpected emergency hospital visits again. And so in that context, my research area in digital emergency medicine is how can technology support the safe and high quality transition of patients between acute and hospital care? So that's where my focus is. And so with that focus, I'm going to discuss about three areas that I do in terms of type of research. One, thinking about the patients and caregivers. So let me start with that. Of course, you know, very often we immediately think about, oh, let's look at websites, let's look at sharing knowledge, et cetera, which is absolutely correct. And in fact, you know, in the last 5 years, I've been prescribing websites to our patients when it comes to the emergency department. But recently I learned a great trick from my colleague, which I'm gonna show you in a moment. But I would pick out sites like Medicine Online or Medline Plus, which is written based on evidence information, good general research-based information to support our patients. And what my colleagues had suggested to me a year ago is, well, why don't you actually put this in part of your prescription pad? So that in fact, when you say search, someone comes in with vertigo, I say, well, it's your middle ear, your liver and thymus. I can then immediately write that word. I can explain what it is. I said, well, if you want further information, you can start with this Medline Plus website, or start with the BC Emergency Medicine Network, which I'll talk a little bit about later on, so they can find the information that they need, together with the whatever action or medications I give them. But of course, website's great, but patient really is asking the question, I don't want just general knowledge, I want knowledge that applies to me. And so a second aspect is about the whole area of patient portal, you know, patient being able to access their own information. In the last 5 years, in fact, in British Columbia, that we have the ability for patients to sign up for my eHealth portal. The same company in Ontario, for those who attend this seminar from there, is over the last 2 years, my results. And in fact, roll out so that the patient in the morning when they do blood tests, by the afternoon, they can see their own blood test results themselves. And also reports, biopsy reports, etc. And in fact, in Ontario, over the last 2 years of rollout of my results, 1.5 million patients have signed up for it and have great experience. And in fact, over the last 5 years, there's almost, when I first started talking about this about 6-7 years ago with our community center folks, that many patients would say, I didn't know about this. You know, maybe one hand goes up. But then in the last year, when I talk about it, about 6 to 7 hands out of 10 hands goes up. And these are like people 65-year-old or older. So a lot of interest in wanting to get that information. However, the issue is for this type of portal is, you know, what does low sodium mean? What does my sodium 135 mean? And so we as health professionals need to work with our patients. And are there ways that we can support this also technologically? And so that naturally takes us to an area of using apps and wearables. It may be interesting to you. Maybe let me stop for a second and ask you a poll question first. I mean, Martin, can you make the magic of the poll happen? My question to you at this time is, do you currently use a mobile phone for knowledge translation activities? Do you currently use a mobile phone to do knowledge translation activities? Maybe I'll ask you to do a bit of voting, and I'll wait for about 15, 20 seconds, and we'll go from there. Martin, you got to orient me to the slide in terms of where I can see the poll results. Ah, there we go. Thank you. Thank you very much. Excellent. So maybe we'll stop there. Does everybody get to see that poll number? Excellent. So we're looking around 46% yes, 54% no. Wonderful. I'd love to continue to have this dialogue with you. By the end of this, you may already be doing this without you realizing it, or we can work together to accelerate that. Going back to our slide, in terms of the app, slide 10, that's important in terms of thinking about using apps and smartphones for non-translation. So I'm going to give you some examples of that in supporting patients finding their own information and also accelerating on the information itself. Very often, what I do is I print out, we actually have in our merchant department a handout for patients to say, well, how do you download apps? But some of them, very obvious. But some of them, they may start learning about it. But you may not be surprised in North America that for those who have a smartphone, I imagine most of you have a smartphone, that you or 7 out of 10 of us would have at least downloaded one health app. 7 out of 10 would have downloaded at least one app. And so again, over the last 2-3 years, that changed my practice, start prescribing apps to our patients. And so I will show you a handout like the slide that you're watching. And so firstly, you know, how do you download a slide? Well, three simple steps. Number one, look at Apple or Android, either Apple Store or Play Store, and then touch that. And when I give you a name, such as Force First Aid, which will be the next app that I'm going to talk with you about, you go to the search field with that magnifying glass, type in first aid, and then there'll be a list of icons associated with that. And pick the icon that I showed to you. And by touching that, you get the screen that says, you know, first aid, Canadian Red Cross. You push that green button, install, it'll start to install. Now, if it's an older version, you still have to put in your password. For a new version, you can use your fingerprint, you can use your face to unlock it, it'll automatically download. So very simple three-step, and sometimes I walk them through, sometimes they've already done it by the time I finish talking about this, and say, doc, keep moving on, which is what I'll do. So for example, this app by Canadian Red Cross, good content, and what it does is it solves one issue. It's when you have a home emergency, what do you do right away? And do you need to go to emergency? That's it. And so what it does is provide a list of first aid, for example, in this list that you see, allergies, asthma, bleeding. In the case of burn, for example, then immediately it'll give you 2 or 3 steps to do. For example, cool the burn under cool water. And so you'll run it for around 2 minutes or so. So give you some general guidelines. Also give you a sense about, you know, hey, if you have a certain size of the burn, you may need to go to emergency department. And also it has, for example, an asthma, heart attack, stroke, they'll have a short video, you know, 30 seconds, 45 seconds, to show you what a stroke might look like, what a heart attack might look like, and then to chart trigger, how do you get to emergencies. So a very strong and long dictionary of these areas. A bit of a bonus too, because Canadian Red Cross is in charge of disasters. In fact, it has sections to talk about disaster medicine. For example, are you prepared for a earthquake, and do you have the 8 things that you need at home to actually look at what you need for earthquakes? So these are some of the things that this particular app can do. So I recommend, I prescribe this to my patient who come to the emergency department pretty general. And then what I do is this, for those in Apple, now for those who use Android, welcome. I don't use Android, but I do teach downloading some of them, but I'm not aware Android having this function, and that's the medical ID function. If you look at that screen, there's that icon with a heart, and that's the health icon. If you click there and you look at the bottom right, there's a icon called medical ID. So you touch that medical ID, this screen will come up. And then you can fill in your medical conditions, for example, the left lower portion, left lower side of that screen, or on the right upper side, your blood type, and also right lower screen, some of the emergency contact numbers. The magic of this screen is the left upper corner, that radio button. As soon as you hit show when locked and turn it on, what it does is it changes your home screen. Now, when you go to home screen, you see emergency and cancel on the bottom. But once you turn that button on, it turns to the medical ID and cancel. And so this changed my practice in the emergency department in null translation. If someone comes in unconscious, confused because of car accident, head trauma, sepsis, overdoses, that in the past I asked a social worker, could you find some people I can call? Right now I look first to see if they have a smartphone. And second, I look if they have medical ID. If they do, I'm gonna touch that and get the information right away. And so again, that's another way of how technology can support the shortening of that knowledge translation and knowledge exchange in communicating with our patients and understanding the issues there. Here's another favorite I do recommend. By the way, I have no financial connection to any of these apps. So I just want to declare that. This is one of many, but this one is free about tracking your medication. And so let's say if I take a bunch of medication, I want to take a vitamin now, that's red pill, that's round. I can program it into this easily to say the name of the vitamin, the circle, and choose the pill and time it at 8 a.m. to take it. As soon as I've done that, it would give me an overall view of that pie chart to say in the morning, you're going to take that pill and the oblong blue pill. In the noontime, you're going to take the green little bear. In the afternoon, nighttime, you don't have any. And overnight, you can take some of those medications. So it kind of split that screen for you. The other nice thing, of course, is that at the right time, the alarm on your mobile phone will go off. And you tie it to your mobile watch, it will actually vibrate your watch and say, 8 o'clock, it's time to take that pill. So this really increased the patient's ability to recall taking the pills, adhere to the medication, but also for us as emergency doctors, if they turn the screen to us and say, doc, here's the medication I take, and here's the frequency I take it, again, help in that shortening of knowledge, communication, and translation sharing of that. So think of this as ways of us, as a pathway for us to shorten that conversation. Currently, we're doing some research in the last half of the year, a group of physicians from 5 hospitals working together to say, well, what can we do to design an emergency department app to support our patients? When patients come into emergency, it's often a mystery to them what that journey is about. How can we help them in so that we can call them at the right time? Restaurants have solved that as opposed to them sitting in a waiting room. How can we communicate information better with them? And on discharge, how can we provide them with the right information so that they can follow up with their family doctors? And if we need to contact them back for a follow-up with abortion results, how can we leverage the use of this app for that? And again, the number of people more and more using apps are increasing. I think this might be one way for us to keep that connection with our patients to move forward. So digital trend number one is think about web, think about portals, think about apps, how to communicate with our patients in that patient room area. I'm going to look at the second area about health practices. How do we connect with our colleagues as health professionals? How do us as researchers enter in that area and connect with our health professionals? This is a great app done by the QXMD. It's a Chilliwack nephrologist who actually started this company. And so this is the calculator where it has many of the calculating formulas. For example, AA gradient or osmolar gap, some of the things that clinicians amongst you may be very familiar with that are tools that we need to do to support our patients. And so these are a collection of those formulas. And so if you have a research that generates a new formula, CHAT2 for assessment of atrial fibrillation, when do we start medications for anticoagulation, the formula is there. So how do we use these types of tools? And then the same company actually developed this app called Read. And what it does is, in fact, you may be interested in this, it's for free, by the way, that you can go into there and say, this is the type of journal articles I'm interested in, emergency medicine. Within that body of literature, I'm interested in the subcontext of trauma. I can do that. And then with that, I'm really interested in the major journals, New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet, et cetera. And then make those selection. And then what this does is every time there's a new article in that area, it'll bounce onto your phone. And also give you a bit of a summary of the type of articles available there. So you can then click and actually download the abstract to start reading it. And if those are open access articles, you will be able to get the whole full text on this. And it can also store reading lists for you. So again, great way for us to triage the synthesis of the knowledge to support us in that care. So called Read by QXMD. Of course, social media, another huge area. In fact, I know that for our residents and our medical students these days, textbooks, it's good, but they all go to social media for the latest tips, pearls, etc. And as a clinician, I also go there to listen to pearls. So in emergency medicine circle, EMRAP is one of those areas where we get a lot of great information fact, this whole movement was started by Dr. Mike Cardigan from Australia, who saw the free online access to medical education, or FOMED network, where we share the knowledge amongst health professionals so that we can exchange knowledge together. And very fortunate, I get to work with a group of medical students over the last 4 years now, looking at how social media can become a teaching and learning tool. And so we're looking at how that contributes to health professional education on social, in terms of knowledge translation as a medium for that. I'm lucky. I work in Vancouver General Hospital Emergency. Often there's at least three or four colleagues around. And so if I encounter a difficult ECG and say, hey, is this Brugada syndrome? I can then take that sheet of ECG and talk to my emergency colleague. If I see an x-ray, it looks like this, I say, well, we don't see TB often. Is this tuberculosis? I can walk up and talk to our radiology colleague and do that. But when you think about the vastness of Canada, we think about the different locations, especially in rural communities, where the physician, the nurse practitioner is working by himself or herself, how can we afford them the same equity of access to colleagues? And so we've been looking at areas like using text messaging and image to do that. And in fact, we did a couple of studies looking at that. In fact, the quality is as good, and the speed of it, within about 5 minutes, we can get it. And it's a very equitable way for our health professionals to be able to get that kind of knowledge that they can. And so again, understanding how to do this, but of course there are issues such as privacy, confidentiality, which I'll come back to later on. But the technology is there to help us to do that kind of support to each other. And of course, in addition to knowledge exchange, what about actual clinical care exchange? Here was a Dr. Swinfer, a neurologist, a neurosurgeon, sorry, connecting with a general surgeon in Terrace back in 2003, looking at doing a burr hole on a patient with a intracranial bleed in Terrace. And of course, at that time, we had that dedicated equipment emergency, but now with the different kinds of technology, we can have physicians connecting with a rash, with a group of patients, or with the patient and their family, or patients with their family doctor, or even on desktop, mobile, video conferencing, in doing all those type of technology. Again, the technology is evolving very rapidly. The question is, how do we use it for health professional exchange to accelerate knowledge translation? I really want to thank Dr. Jim Christensen, is the lead, the head of Department of Emergency Medicine at UBC. He has created and started a network together with the emerging physicians in the province so that we can connect together. There are 95 emergency departments in British Columbia with 1,100 physicians, family doctors, emergency doctors providing emergency services, and we hit 2 million patients a year. How do we look at technology to link us all together so that we can help each other? In fact, even a bolder vision for Dr. Christensen is, how do we look at this as one big emergency department, just happen to be 95 sites, and how do we work together? And so we've started that BC Emergency Medicine Network. We're hoping that this network will create that opportunity for connections. So first trend, prescribing apps, portals, and web for our patients. Second is, how do we look at using technology for virtual conferencing and mutual consultation between health professionals? The third really is about health system. How do we leverage technology in health system to accelerate knowledge translation? Very fortunately, about 6 years ago, we started looking in the whole area of wearables and sensors. At that time, we obtained a grant to look at diabetes home care. At that point, biosensor was just coming up, and so we're using glucose, blood pressure, weight as a sensor activity. But in the middle square, we want the health professionals and the patient to have a way to communicate, and so we use some text messaging, secure text messaging. And finally, we also engage our patients and their caregivers in a secure social media way so that they can do their own knowledge exchange themselves. And so with this system, we're able to do a convenient sample to monitor up to 50 patients and caregivers in over a 3 month period of time and see if that actually affects diabetic care. And we're very encouraged by the results that we're able to help the patients in general to bring their A1C under control, under 7, being a good number that we want to achieve. And secondly, On average, patients lost weight by 3.5 pounds. And in these cases, they were good that they lost weight. And then systolic blood pressure reduction. In serving the patient themselves, they feel decreased health stress and increased empowerment for diabetes management. And so encouraged by that, a group of us were able to go to CIHR and 3 years ago obtain a 4-year grant to look at this study of supporting patients being discharged from home, discharged from hospital to home, can sensors and wearables support them in their convalescence? And so this project is called Tech for Home. We first focus on heart failure patients. Ladies and gentlemen, if you and I today have heart failure and we're admitted to the hospital and get discharged, one in four of us will be readmitted to the hospital within 1 month and four in 10 within 3 months. There are two things in the literature that suggest that we can decrease that readmission rate. Number one is how professionals can support patients better while they're at home. And number two is the patient improve their self-management. And so the idea is, can monitoring with technologies and sensors support health professionals, support our patients better, and support patients themselves in better self-management? And so in this study, as you see on the screen, that the patient will have their own blood pressure cuff, they will have a weight scale, they'll put a oxygen saturation monitor on their finger, and then they also have a tablet so that they can answer some questions. Do you feel short of breath today? Did you faint today? Do you have chest pain? And so the patient are provided with, on the right side of the screen, a self-management heart failure guide. And so safe zone means everything's going well, no weight gain, not short of breath. Yellow zone may be, I've gained 2 pounds over 24 hours, 5 pounds over 48 hours. That usually means it's accumulating fluids. And so our nurse, there'll be a monitoring nurse, there is a monitoring nurse who actually followed patients and looked at their data. And if that happens, the monitoring nurse will call the patient and say, hey, is there something we can do to adjust your diet, your fluid intake? Or the monitoring nurse will contact the family doctor and say, can we adjust the medications for this particular patient? And if you have red symptoms, a chest pain for half an hour, I fainted, I feel very short of breath, we ask the patient, yeah, the monitoring nurse will prioritize these calls, but don't wait. If that's the case, call the ambulance, go to the hospital. And so with that, we look at phase one we implemented at Vancouver General Hospital, St. Paul's, and Kelowna General Hospital. And we're able to test our protocol. And in three hospitals, we got a consecutive recruitment of 70 patients. And we're very happy that in a small sample, that we're able to find a 59% decrease in readmission over 90 days. In 3 months, we decreased by almost 60%. 44% decrease in emergency department revisit, a 44% decrease in patient cost. So that it, in fact, this is a triple A measurements that we're able to capture that cost. And finally, for the patient, they have statistically improved quality of life. And now the number sounds ridiculous, 101% improvement. Now how did it improve 101%? The scale we use is called Kansas City Cardiomyopathy Quality of Life Scale, and it's out of 100. The average score is 33, higher the better, and the post score 67, and that's why it's 101%. But regardless, I think the quality of life is better for this patient. So as a researcher, I love this result. But as a clinician, I love this result. The patient says, this is the best I've felt in 2 years. This is the longest I've stayed out of hospital. TELUS is the corporate company that worked with us on this project. I may not let TELUS come in and collect the equipment at 60 days. I want to keep the equipment. Or people who have not seen me for a while tell me what difference, and even your voice is stronger. And so what we are very fortunate that phase one was showed this results, and now we're embarking on phase two. We go live on August 1st. We now have 19 communities that are now enrolled in four health authorities. And of those 19, we're hoping to collect 900 patients, 450 experiment, 450 control, so that we can validate to see if, in fact, in that larger number, we are achieving that same result or not. And secondly, we also want to see, is there similarities or differences of patients in rural and remote community compared to urban communities? And that's why we're very fortunate to have, you know, groups like Delta, Abbotsford, Lillooet, Williams Lake, Powell River, wanting to work together with Vancouver General, Surrey, St. Paul's, etc. So we can actually look at that difference. And the knowledge translation research that we're doing is what we call a web stepwise trial. What we want to do is, as opposed to a classic randomized controlled trial, we can't blind the patient and the physician on the technology. We can't give them Toys R Us monitor and give them fake data. Can't do that, right? And so what we do is we engage the 19 sites, randomly assign them to four clusters, at group 1, 2, 3, 4. And then with that, the first cluster, all of them will start August 1st to enroll control patients. And then after the first step of 3 months, we switch them, the first cluster, to experiment to start monitoring patients. And then 3 months later, a second cluster go live, the third cluster, fourth cluster, et cetera. And the reason we use this model is because, number one, it has to be justified that there's some positive results as a pilot, which we do. And secondly, this way, all sites will be able to monitor patients as opposed to some sites that didn't get the monitor. And finally, if the result is positive, then you can see that all 19 sites will be ready and able to deploy the technology. So it shortens the knowledge translation cycle. They can choose to actually start right away, as opposed to waiting for the randomized control trial, wait for 2 years before it gets studied, and then start to the knowledge translation in moving that forward. And so we're very excited about this. Hopefully that there's a chance for me to come back and talk with you about the results. We're also embarking on COPD, and also in stroke and using home monitoring. In fact, for COPD, I'm very fortunate that Vancouver Coastal Health has chosen to actually now trial it for implementation. So me as a clinician now, I can prescribe home health monitoring to a COPD patient in the emergency department. So my final few slides, Apple Watch, in fact, do you know that is now certified as a medical device since October to track atrial fibrillation? This is a cardia 2 years ago. This not only monitor your pulse rate, it can actually read ECG well enough to diagnose heart attack on mobile. This is a flow meter, no bigger than a USB stick. It actually tells you the air quality. So in fact, if you have COPD and asthma, you'll detect the air quality in your room and say, hey, it's very dense. And it'll say, get out of that room. It'll show you a GPS to say, go over there. It's actually better for you. Peak flows attached to mobile phones. This was just this year in January. Omron is now releasing a watch that can continuously monitor your blood pressure, as opposed to doing it on your elbow and your upper arm. Edible is the new wearable. November 2017, FDA has approved the first pill sensor that allows patient to track having swallowed the pill to increase adherence. The next device may not be earth-shattering for many of us, but for those with spinal cord injuries, for those with Parkinson's disease, for those with stroke, what this Google spoon does, it maintains a level spoon so that they can feed themselves, and then they can use that to dig into food. Imagine the autonomy this gives back to our patients. With these devices, why wouldn't we want to prescribe it? And in all of these, it's not just about us and patient. It's not just us and health professional. We need a health system to support the integration of sensors and wearables into our system. And so our third piece about the trend is, how do we look at wearables and sensors in the short term to actually deploy these technology for knowledge translation? And my final piece is this, the fourth trend is really about sharing. So we've established a webinar, pretty similar to KT Connects. But this one is focusing on clinical implementation of virtual health. If you're interested, love to have you join us. Dr. John Polovich is from Department of Family Practice, worked with me on this together through the UBC CPD Department, Continued Professional Development Department. We also established a lab at Vancouver General Hospital. It's called Demonstration Simulation Studio for Health, or DASH Lab. We think about Disneyland, the future land. This is what this is about. And we wanted to be a bit of a petting zoo of technology. So we established a room that looks like a home, a room that looks like an emergency department, a room that looks like a doctor's office. And we'll put technology, how do they unintrusively participate in this environment, how will patients use it, how health professionals use it, and then use this technology. So if any of you are coming to Vancouver, if you're interested, I'd love to show you our lab. And so the fourth strategy is a very important one for all of us in all translations. How do we create that synergy and sharing of digital technologies? Now, I don't want to gloss over some of the challenges because there are. Number one is, well, how do we support patients to know how to use the technology? Volkswagen has a great commercial campaign a while ago. It's called Drivers Wanted. You can build the best car in the world, but if nobody knows how to drive it, it's never fulfilled the function of what it's meant to be. We can roll out portals, we can roll out apps, etc., but we don't raise the digital health literacy of our population, of our health professionals, of our policymakers. It'll be very hard for us to get there. And so how do we do that? Also, yeah, 7 out of 10 people use apps, but 3 out of 10 don't. So when they come to the emergency department, I have an app. How do we make sure that those 3 out of 10 don't get marginalized? How do we make sure that, you know, because of cost, because of use of technology, because of financial education, whatever it is that marginalized a person, how do we make sure that we still serve those people and serve them well? Privacy, confidentiality, very important about the data, making sure that when we use things like, you know, text messaging, we just don't use the ones that are on our phone, that's very insecure, but use ways that are sanctioned that help, that we can use compliant with technology. Data storage, piracy, very important area. Increase time and efforts to workflow for health professionals, very important. You know, with the deployment of electronic health record, we know that it decreases health professionals' efficiency by 20%. So how do we compensate for that when we use technology? How do we keep up, right? I'm just giving you a small view of this, and I feel very fallen behind already. And so how do we help each other to actually strengthen and build that up? And so my final thought is this, that I think when you think about knowledge translation, there are some key steps that we need to achieve. And number one is, how do we introduce a culture of knowledge translation? I think it absolutely becomes a very foundational piece. But I think the next piece is very important. How do we engage individuals like ourselves, like our colleagues, so we can animate those partnerships to vivify the culture of knowledge translation? I think the next step is where the technology comes in. Well, we need to establish a system of knowledge translation. How do we consider technology as a part of it? Not the only one, but a part of setting up a system of KT, of apps, of patient portals, of health professional knowledge exchange, of health system transformation, so that we can carry that out. And then with that, how do we reinforce that system of change, that circle of action? It's not just about one side, but it's about the context. Context is king. How do we make sure that we understand the context, and how can knowledge accelerate that context in incorporation knowledge? And then very important, how do we evaluate the outcome so that we can learn from it? And through that, it helps us to continuously improve knowledge translation. And technology has an advantage here in that it can seamlessly carry and capture the data that's necessary for us to learn and accelerate that knowledge translation. I think that will lead us to success in knowledge translation. I used to, several years ago, I bought a piano for my kids. I got two kids. So we went into this piano store. And the salesperson happened to have a master's of music degree. And so when I asked her a question, how should we solve for a piano? And she said very simply, you only need three things. Every time you play that note, it gives you the purity of what that note is meant to be. And secondly, when you play that note, it gives you the depth so that it feels like the note's actually hugging you. And the third is when you play the different notes, that all the notes connect together in harmony. If you have those three things, you got a great piano. And this is why you need to spend $10,000 on the Steinway. Ladies and gentlemen, in similar ways, each of you are pure in your knowledge translation research and interest. And many of you have achieved that depth of doing so. I think the key about knowledge translation is how do we work together to really connect our notes together so that we can harmonize, so we can really play beautiful music in knowledge translation. And so in thinking about patient and caregiver engagement, in thinking about collegial exchange of knowledge, in thinking about health system synchronization, how do we work together so we can contribute our purity of our notes, the depth of our research, and collective connectionness a collective success in bringing this knowledge translation into play. A couple of publications that we did in 2012, a book on technology-enabled knowledge translation, and also recently a BC Medical Journal. You can access it online if you're out of province. Two guest editorial journals on technology use in health. And in part two, there's an article specifically about health apps and wearables if you're interested. So again, thank you very much for your attention. I think I went over my time limits. I have one more poll question. So I want to break the rest of the time for some conversations with you. My question is, would you consider using the increase the use of digital technology for knowledge translation in work in the coming year? Really start to think about an action mode. Would you consider increasing that in your work? I'd love to hear your thoughts and see where we are in the audience. Also, this is one of those nervous moments. If everybody said no, I know I haven't done my job. All right, so maybe we'll give it another 5-10 seconds. I think the vote has gone to around 60. Fantastic, thank you. Why don't we stop there? Thank you very much, everyone. I look forward to the interaction period right now.
Great, wonderful. Thank you, Kendall. It's quite clear that you're conducting a symphony of beautiful music in KT in digital health. So thank you for your presentation and your insights. We welcome all participants to submit their questions via the chat panel. And while we're waiting for some questions to come in, I'll start with one. So suppose I'm engaging in a tremendous research project like Tech for Home. What are the benefits of situating that within the knowledge to action cycle that you introduced in the beginning?
Yeah. So thanks for that, Martin. So for example, Tech for Home, we very fortunately, in health system research, we have health policymakers, with clinicians, with researchers, also technology company that participate. But one other thing that was very, very fortunate for us is the environment of engaging patients. So we actually had patients participating. And that changed everything. That was a fantastic thing that we had patient engagement. Because I think when we did that research, that in fact, knowledge translation starts at the planning of the research, as opposed to let's synthesize the knowledge and then apply it into practice. Two things I learned for patients, as an example. We're planning, this is about surveillance, monitoring patients, supporting our patient in optimal care, supporting them in self-management. And our patient colleague says, this is great, this is fantastic. But why do you call it monitoring? Why don't you call it co-monitoring? That was an aha moment, because it's about patients and health professionals working together to co-monitor a situation. And so that was a huge aha moment for us, actually. Look at that piece. And the second one is this, that when we were designing the study, we say, well, for the eligible patient, our primary outcome is about 90-day readmission to hospital. And so I did a bit of an intellectual leap and said, therefore, patients who are in palliative care would not be eligible for the study. As a researcher, it makes sense, but the patient immediately react and say, why are healthcare patients not important? And I can see why that connection's there. And it pulls me right back and say, well, you're absolutely right. I shouldn't have said that. What I should have said is, for the context of this study, that because the palliative care patients won't be coming back to hospital, that they won't be able to be eligible for this study for the outcome that we're looking for. However, palliative care patients are very important. And so when we knowledge translate, there's no question that we need to engage them. So I think that understanding becomes very important. It helped me self-correct in doing those. And that really helps in moments in the study to help me to make sure I'm on the right course.
Wonderful. That's great. Another question here. What role can hospital leadership play in KT and adoption of innovation?
I think hospital plays two roles. When you think about knowledge translation, there's the micro, in terms of patients, patient health professional interaction one-on-one. And there's a meso where it's about a clinic, it's about a hospital, it's about a kind of the implementation of the service. I think that's number one. For hospital leadership, policymakers, health administrator, that's a huge role to say in that meso system, how can our health system participate in that? Because I may say, well, the evidence shows that wearables and sensors are fantastic. but if a hospital says, this is great, I have no budget for you, that's the end of knowledge translation. But if the hospital see the advantage of it, if we then say, well, by doing this, we actually can actually economize by 44%, then hospital leaders can then say, well, with that economization, how can I find ways to adopt the system? And that brainstorming, as a health professional, a health researcher, I can't do that. And the third piece that they can be helpful is the macro system. To look at the provincial implementation of health system, hospitals and health administrator plays a huge role in influencing and be influenced by the health system. So again, help us to bridge that macro, meso, and micro system for us to actually do knowledge translation.
Andrew? Great. And one more here. What needs to happen for the health system to move forward with the integration of wearables?
I think generation of ideas is always important because there's always ways that we can do things better. But if we orient to the health system, I think we need to start with a health gap to say, what are we not doing well today? And how can innovation start to address that? I think that's number one. Number two is we need to work with them to do the co-planning together to say, this is how we would think about innovation. Does that make sense to you? Because again, if it doesn't make sense to the health system, it won't work. Number three is it's vitally important that we do evaluation. For example, the triple aim of the quadruple aim framework to look at end user experiences, look at health outcome, look at cost effectiveness, and also the right context so health professionals can participate. Again, very important that evaluation. I think through that, and ultimately what is the most important is building trust. It's that trust that helps us to start working together and move that forward.
Great, great. And one more question. What do you think made Tech for Home so successful in helping people self-manage? And are there situations you anticipate where Tech for Home would not be so successful?
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think for the home monitoring of sensors, which is what Tech for Home is about, for the patients, what makes it successful is the patient are able to see their own numbers. I think that becomes a foundational piece. You know, as a doctor, for example, if someone has a heart attack, comes in the hospital and then leave, I said, you need to exercise 3 times a week, 30 minutes. It's very hard for the patient to say, well, how hard do I exercise? You know, and during those 30 minutes, what should I watch out for? But if I can be very specific to them and say, because you're on a beta blocker, I expect your heart rate not to increase too much. So maybe heart rate increase around 5 to 10%. But make sure that your blood pressure doesn't drop below 120 and make sure that your oxygen saturation doesn't drop below 95%. And with that, if you can sustain it for 30 minutes without feeling dizzy, without being short of breath and sweating, that's where your limit is. And the patient will have very specific things that they can follow up on. And so the same way for this, I think the advantage for patients, they can see their own weights and start to correlate, oh, weights with fluid intake has a correlation. So that they can start to experiment with it within the context of these and know where the safe numbers are, not extreme with sensor wearables, but know where the safe limits are for. And then communicate with health professionals to guide them along. I think that's what the advantage is, the disadvantage. I think those technology is still needing the patient, for example, put on a blood pressure cuff. And we look at population, usually for young, old, 65 to 75, 80. In fact, those individuals are very adept to using technology to talk to their grandkids. They have, by and large, the ability to afford technology, and they have time to play with technology. So they love technology. But for the old, 75, 80 to 90, it's much harder for them to adopt technology. So we need to understand for those group, how do we design better sensors, better wearables, so that we can draw on exactly the same benefits without having technology being interfering with what they do.
Great, and I think this next question is a turn on that, but from the systems perspective. So what about the population that doesn't have access to the technology at all? So recognizing that approximately 3 in 10 people won't have smartphones or access to or familiarity with the tech, do you and your research teams have backup plans when prescribing apps and websites to your patients so they don't feel disconnected from resources?
Yeah, thank you for that question. That's a very important question about equity. And you're absolutely right. You know, if 3 or 4 out of 10 patients can't use it, how do we do it, right? And so I think that's where the context becomes important. First of all, let me say, that wouldn't stop the person asked the question nor me to do the research, because it would benefit 6 out of 10, 7 out of 10 patients. So this is worthwhile research to do. While doing that though, figuring out how do we support those who are underserved. So there are some models out there, for example, in downtown Eastside in Vancouver, that they have a communal mobile phone that you can actually text to that phone. And in fact, people who don't have mobile phone in that community can go there and get their messages. And so that may be one way. And secondly, very interesting, we're trying to connect a patient in the emergency department follow-up. And so they're on the registration sheet, no fixed address, no telephone. And I was working as a social worker for half a day, just couldn't figure out, et cetera. But finally, we come up with a person's friend after about a day and a half. And so we call the friend and say, hey, how can we get hold of this patient? And they said, well, why don't you just post a message on Facebook? And so we did. Within 1 minute, literally within 1 minute, they called us back, that person. So we need to think about adaptive ways to say, well, it may not work this way, but are there alternative ways to do it? International Telecommunication Union, ITU, which is in Geneva, has declared access to internet as a human right in 2012. How do we look at that and say, with that, how do we implement it? How do we make sure that those who don't have access currently to internet or to digital technology raise that technology and raise that support? I think it's a very important question. I don't have a straightforward answer for you, but it's very clear we need to think about how to do it.
Great. And it's very well possible that your research is helping move that mission forward.
Hopefully.
Another question, what do you think the future business model for tech in healthcare is? Who bears the cost? What role will industry have? And what role does the government or public system have?
Wow, thank you very much for that question. It's a very important debate. I asked a friend of mine who is, very well off. And I asked him, if you use sensors and wearables for wellness, do you think government needs to pay for it? And he immediately said, no, of course not. I'll pay for my own watch, I'll pay for my own Fitbit, et cetera. And I turned around and said, if you go in hospital because of illness and on discharge, your physician prescribed you sensors, do you think you should pay for it? Do you think government should pay for it? And he hesitates. He said, well, maybe the government needs to pay for it. I think it's a very important debate, a very important discussion, how to do that, right? And when we were surveying our patients who use Tech for Home, our project, when we surveyed patients, in fact, it was interesting that 66% of the patients said, I would consider paying for the system. Now, the question is, how much would they pay? How much would they afford? But don't forget, there's still 33% of patients said, I can't. I can't afford it. I just have to get sick. It's not fair, et cetera. So the 33% is there. So question for us, I think that's a very important question, not only the question itself, who should pay for technology and healthcare, who bears the cost, but I think it's a very important knowledge translation question. Because if you are in a community, in a context where people in general cannot afford this, then we need to figure out a way in that context to generate the evidence to support that population to use it. And so I think it's a social discussion. I think it's very important contextual consideration. And I think that question that you asked will be a very important question for us to consider as a society to do that. Do I have an answer for you? I would suggest that it would be a mixed model of government supporting some of it for illness, patient and user supporting some of it for wellness, but we have to have a way to, I'm thinking Canadian, we have to have a way to judge equity and support for those. For those who can't afford, can we make some exception to the rule? And also right now, the excitement is that a lot of discussion about smart cities. Companies want to make a whole city smart and so that all the businesses rise. But when we do that smart city as a system, can we think about making everybody improve? Just like a tide that brings all the boats up, can we use smart city to support those who might be underserved so that we can find a way to support them so that they can be connected? I think those are some of the ways that both on the government in the private sector and also end users? How do we come to agreements how to fund this?
Great. And one final question before we run out of time. Thank you for all of the examples of e-health apps that you showed, and clearly the ones that you showed are designed well. Do you have any tips for how to filter out the apps that are perhaps less evidence-based?
Thank you. So I would suggest a few quick principles for us to consider. For me to prescribe an app, number one is I need to know that app. So I usually would use the app myself, play around with it, and then talk to my patient about it. Because it's very hard if I don't use that app and say, oh, we'll use this, and then if something wrong, it's very hard. If I know it, it's better. Number two is a safe app in general does not mean it's a safe app for the patient. And so we need to understand the patient's context. You know, when you use this app, you know, maybe, you know, 220% of heart rates is a good limit for people to exercise, but it's not for you with a heart attack, right? And so I think understanding patient context is important. And so the second key principle is that I think the patient needs to work with health professional as a partnership to use app, rather than the patient themselves just using the app on its own. I think that's the second piece. The third piece is I think we need to help track and monitor the patient's use of that app so that as it evolves, it doesn't have any side effect. We do that with medication and say, you know, come back and see me in 2 weeks, make sure your blood pressure is still good with this blood pressure drugs. So in the same way for apps, we need to do that. And I think the last piece is this. I think we need to be, as health professionals, need to be humble. Because very often patients find some apps that we don't know about. And so I think as health professionals, we can learn about, you know, what the patients brought to us and ask the question, oh, wow, this is great. Why did you find this app? And why do you think this app helped you? And then help us to then say, okay, this is why you use this app to track your blood sugar, track your weight, to track your finance so that you can afford these things. Then it helps us to further understand deeply what the patient wants and then help them with it. So I think those four things. And then finally, I think I want to come back to the fourth trend is that if we can share together. At the end of the day, I only know a handful of apps. If you try out a handful of apps that we can do together and share that, it'll be amazing. At the BC Emergency Medicine Network, we put up those apps that we have been using. If you can join that conversation and add your apps to it, it'll be amazing.
Wonderful. Great. And that concludes our question and answer period. Before we wrap up for today, I want to sincerely thank you, Kendall Ho, for offering this webinar.
Thank you.
It's quite clear that you're adapting KT and the knowledge to action cycle across many different contexts. And it's great that you gave us an overview of some of the trends you see over your vast experience. And to the audience, thank you for joining us. Please take a few moments to share your thoughts on today's webinar. A survey will appear automatically after the webinar has ended. For more information about KT and to explore supplemental resources, a few links have been provided for you in the chat box. One final reminder that all webinars will be recorded and archived at www.msfhr.org/KT Connects. That concludes our webinar for today. Have a great day, everyone. You're now free to disconnect.
Thank you very much.